What we're going to do is, we have a business meeting that we need to conduct. Of course, we need a quorum in order to do that, so we're still waiting on some members to arrive. So we will go ahead and move into the hearing portion of the legislation this morning. Mr. Grayson has not arrived yet, so we will go ahead and move into some other issues. Then we'll recess briefly to bring Ms. Rice onto the full committee and also put her on her subcommittees. We'll adjourn the business meeting and then go right back into the hearing. So we'll be a little convoluted today, but thank you all for being here. We're here to talk about five pieces of legislation this morning. In the interest of time, I'm going to forego a lengthy opening statement and just briefly touch on two bills on the agenda, which I'm proud to have introduced before this Congress. The first bill is H.R. 280. The language is similar to a bill that I introduced last Congress, which passed favorably out of this committee. H.R. 280 would provide the Secretary with the authority to rescind a bonus or performance award from any VA employee when the Secretary deems it appropriate. Now, to ensure a fair process, the provision would also afford the employee an opportunity to have a hearing on the Secretary's decision to recoup their bonus. I proposed this legislation last Congress because VA had given this committee conflicting statements on whether or not it already had the ability to rescind bonuses. For example, former Secretary Shinseki rescinded the then Phoenix Director Sharon Hellman's 2013 bonus because it was paid based on an administrative error. Notwithstanding this limited authority, VA later confirmed it did not have the ability to rescind a bonus that was based on erroneous performance data. I believe the ability to recoup a bonus based on bad or manipulated performance data is a tool that the Secretary needs and that the American public would expect. Now, the second bill that I've introduced is H.R. 294, the Long-Term Care Veterans Choice Act. This would authorize VA for 3 years, beginning October 1 of 2015, to enter into a contract or an agreement with a certified medical foster home to pay for long-term care for certain veterans already eligible for VA-paid nursing home care. It would also receive an eligible veteran, yet it would require that an eligible veteran could receive VA home health services as a component of such payments. Medical foster homes provide a non-institutional, long-term care alternative to veterans who prefer a smaller, more home-like and family-style setting than most traditional nursing homes are able to provide. The VA has been helping place veterans in medical foster homes for more than a decade. VA does not currently have authority to pay for a veteran to receive care in a medical foster nursing home, even if the veteran is eligible for VA-paid nursing home care. As a result, service-connected veterans who would prefer to receive care in a foster home must pay out of pocket using their own personal funds, and many are unable to do so because of financial constraints. Our veterans, particularly those who are service-connected and in need of long-term care, deserve to decide for themselves where they and how they receive the care they need, and H.R. 294 would allow them that opportunity. Now, given that the average cost of a medical foster home is approximately half the monthly nursing home cost, H.R. 294 would also provide a cost-effective long-term care option for the department. And I'd urge my colleagues to support both of these bills and look forward to discussing them with our witnesses this morning. Ms. Brown has a bill on the agenda that I'm proud to be a co-sponsor of, and at this time I'll defer to her for her explanation and an opening statement. Ms. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for holding this hearing today. This is the first legislative hearing of the 114th Congress. I'm looking forward to this committee in our usually bipartisan fashion, being busy and looking at bills that will help our veterans and assist the VA in its effort to accomplish its mission. I'm especially pleased that my bill, H.R. 216, was included today. H.R. 216 was introduced last Congress by the former ranking member and was approved by this committee as part of the Advanced Appropriation Bill. I'm looking forward to working with my colleagues and stakeholders to move this bill as fast as we can this year. VA financial management process often looks like a budget at crisis. H.R. 216 would provide the framework to assist the VA in the steps it has already taken to reform its budget process. It is important that everyone have a copy of the rules, and by putting this process into statute, we'll make sure that they do. Providing a roadmap each year so that VA, veterans, and Congress knows where we are, what's going on, and how we can reform the VA. My bill will ensure that the steps taken to come up with the roadmaps are transparent and that all stakeholders are fully engaged in making sure that we provide the resources that we are committed to our veterans demand. So thank you, Mr. Chairman, for including H.R. 216 today. I'm looking forward to the hearing from our witnesses, and I also want to welcome my colleague from Florida, Mr. Grayson, who is, we are joined each other in Orlando.
Thank you very much, Ms. Brown. I want to recognize a new member to the committee that wasted no time in introducing a bill that will affect positively the veterans of our country, Dr. Abraham, to discuss his bill that's before us today, H.R. 245. Dr. Abraham, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to address a bill that I've offered, H.R. 245, to amend Title 38 United States Code to codify certain existing provisions of law relating to effective dates for claims under the laws administered by the Secretary of Veterans Affairs and for other purposes. This bill is not only important to the veterans of my home state of Louisiana, but also to millions of veterans nationwide, particularly those who live in rural areas or those who may be unfamiliar with the claims process of the VBA. Veterans Benefits Administration. The department has devoted much of its time in recent months to devising means to cut time out of the claims process in furtherance of its goal to issue rating decisions within 125 days. While all stakeholders are in favor of seeking process efficiency, we must remain cognizant that this system is, at its core, meant to be veteran-friendly. While the appropriateness and the legality, equity of many of VBA's efforts to issue faster decisions must bear further scrutiny, this particular rule change on informal claims and inferred claims must be addressed now. And H.R. 245 strikes a middle ground between the current operation of VBA and the desired standardization sought by VBA. Essentially, my bill would provide that if a veteran sent a handwritten informal claim to the VA, the department would retract the claims as of the date of receipt of the veteran's correspondence. The department would still send the veteran a standardized form for completion. Provided that the veteran returned the standardized form within 180 days of the date that the department furnished the form to the veteran, the date of the veteran's original submission will continue to be recognized as the veteran's effective date. This protects the veteran as it ensures that any departmental administrative delay will not negatively affect the veteran's rights. My bill also maintains identification of inferred claims with those who have the requisite expertise, who are the trained professionals of the Department of Veterans Affairs. I also understand that veterans may have but be unaware of service-connected conditions that may be evident in their medical records, but which may be absent from their formal claim. For example, a veteran might claim a knee injury tied to a bad jump, but be unaware that a more serious condition, such as depression attributable to an event in service, is also eligible for compensation and treatment. Well, it is my belief that if a claim comes to the Department of Veterans Affairs and there is something the department can do to assist that veteran, the department should, in fact, assist that veteran. There's surely a balance to be struck between department efficiency and veteran-friendly practice, and while I'll agree that some standardization of process is necessary, it must also be accomplished in a manner that prioritizes the veteran over the bureaucrat. I believe my bill strikes that balance. I thank the chairman for including H.R. 245 in our proceedings today, and I urge my colleagues to support its passage. I yield back.
Thank you very much, Dr. Abraham. At this time, I want to welcome our colleague from the 9th District of Florida, Mr. Alan Grayson, who is the sponsor of H.R. 189, the Service Member Foreclosure Protections Extension Act of 2015. Mr. Grayson, welcome to the committee. You're recognized for 5 minutes to explain your bill.
Thank you, Chairman Miller, Ranking Member Brown. Thank you very much for inviting me to appear before you today. I look forward to what this committee, under leadership of two Floridians, will be able to accomplish for our nation's veterans during the 114th Congress. My bill, H.R. 189, the Service Member Foreclosure Protections Extension Act of 2015, would extend for one calendar year the foreclosure and eviction protections that currently exist for active duty members of our military forces and for veterans who have served in our armed forces within the previous year. These protections are scheduled to expire at the end of 2015 unless we act. Historically, Section 303 of the Service Members Civil Relief Act has protected service members from foreclosure and eviction if an action is filed during or within 90 days after a period of military service. Section 2203 of the Housing and Economic Recovery Act of 2008 extended the period of protection from 90 days to 9 months. And in 2012, Congress, in a bill which you authored, Mr. Chairman, extended foreclosure and eviction protections further to 1 year. My bill would ensure that this one-year protection period that currently exists is extended through the end of 2016. Mr. Chairman, as you will recall, we began discussing this provision of law in September of last year after I noticed its omission from H.R. 5404, the Department of Veterans Affairs Expiring Authority Act of 2014, which was ultimately signed into law. You voiced your general support for the current foreclosure and eviction protections, but you stated that you wish to hold a legislative hearing on the measure prior to moving any extension to the floor. I'm pleased that Senator Sheldon Whitehouse was able to pass a clean one-year extension at the end of 2014 that lasts through the end of 2015 through the Senate during the closing days of the last session of Congress, and I'm pleased that you've decided to make an extension into 2016, one of the first pieces of legislation to consider before the committee in this Congress, demonstrating that not everything in Washington, D.C. has to wait till the last minute. It's vitally important that we pass H.R. 189. Without this extension at the end of this year, the period of foreclosure and eviction protections currently made available to service members will revert from 1 year all the way back to the original 90-day period. A lapse in a full year's worth of protection would harm our young men and women returning from war. Almost a year ago, the GAO issued a report entitled Service Members Civil Relief Act, Information on Mortgage Protections and Related Education Efforts. Page 13 of that report states as follows, quote, "Our analysis of one servicer's data suggests that all military borrowers, SCRA protected or not, had a higher likelihood of becoming delinquent in the first year after they left active duty than when in the military. For example, in the loan level data from the institution that used the DMDC database to check the military status of its entire loan portfolio, all of its military borrowers had a higher likelihood of becoming delinquent in the first year after they left active duty than when in service. And that risk declined somewhat over the course of the year, but still remains significant. Mr. Chairman, we currently protect recent veterans and soldiers from the unfortunate situation just described. Clearly, it's a very real threat to the well-being of the young men and women who serve in the armed forces. Respectfully, I urge this committee to continue to ensure that the foreclosure and eviction protections that appear in the current law continue to exist in full measure throughout 2016. No soldier should ever have to fight abroad and return home only to find that home is no longer there. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Grayson. I do appreciate your tenacity and willingness to work with the committee and appreciate you bringing the legislation forward. I will forego a round of questions for Mr. Grayson and I would ask that any questions that members may have of Mr. Grayson be submitted for the record. And I appreciate you being here today, Mr. Grayson, and you are excused.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And I would go ahead and invite the second panel to come forward. And as you're coming forward to the table, we will temporarily recess this hearing and go into our official business meeting because we do, in fact, have a quorum. So this business meeting is now called to order. We need to officially welcome a new member to our Veterans Affairs Committee. Ms. Kathleen M. Rice represents the 4th Congressional District, the state of New York. You got any snow there today? All right. We have some vacancies on both the Subcommittee on Oversight and Investigations and the Subcommittee on Economic Opportunity, and we'll now fill our subcommittee vacancies. You have a copy of the official resolution in your packets. I now recognize the ranking member of the committee, Ms. Brown, for resolution.
Thank you. The resolution provides that the Representative Rice be added as a member of the Subcommittee on Oversight and Investigations and Economic Opportunity is in front of you, and I urge the adoption.
I now recognize Ms. Brownlee for a motion on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I move to approve the resolution adding Ms. Rice as a member of the Subcommittees on Oversight and Investigations and Economic Opportunity.
There's a motion before us. All those in favor will say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. The ayes have it. Congresswoman Rice, welcome to the House Committee on Veterans Affairs. We're looking forward to your participation in very important discussions and legislation. And this concludes our business for today. This business meeting is now adjourned. Okay, we'll bring back the hearing now on pieces of legislation. Our second panel is at the table. We'll hear from David McClinican,
thank you.
Acting Deputy Undersecretary for Disability Assistance for the Veterans Benefits Administration of the VA. He's accompanied by Mr. Rajiv.
Jane, Assistant
Deputy Undersecretary for Health for Patient Services at VA's Health Administration. Ms. Susan Sullivan, I get that one pretty well, I think. Deputy Assistant Secretary for Policy at VA's Office of Policy and Planning. Kim McLeod, Counsel, the VA's Office of General Counsel. Thank you all for being here today. I appreciate your attending. The Deputy Secretary, Acting Deputy Undersecretary, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Good morning, Chairman Miller, Ranking Member Brown, and members of the committee. Thank you for the opportunity to present VA's views on several bills that are pending before the committee. Joining me today are Dr. Jane, Assistant Deputy Undersecretary for Health and Patient Services, Ms. Susan Sullivan, Deputy Assistant Secretary for Policy, and Ms. Kim McLeod, Deputy Assistant General Counsel. I want to first thank the committee for the opportunity to testify concerning a bill we support, H.R. 294, the Long-Term Care Veterans Choice Act. We strongly support the concepts provided in the bill, which permits VA to pay for care for veterans transferred to medical foster homes and at the same time realize cost savings for a more effective manner of care. Despite this strong support, we do have a few technical concerns with the approach outlined in the bill. We hope to work with the committee going forward to ensure VA is able to effectively implement the provisions of the bill. We thank the ranking member for her efforts related to H.R. 216. We are happy to say that VA is undertaking many of the efforts outlined in the bill. Over the last few years, VA incorporated forward-looking environmental scanning into our quadrennial strategic planning process. We have been in the process of implementing a planning, programming, budgeting, and execution resource allocation initiative modeled after similar efforts used in other federal agencies. Under VA's current organizational structure, the Assistant Secretary for Policy and Planning performs the responsibilities described for the proposed Chief Strategy Officer. Additionally, to better serve veterans, the department has been evaluating our organizational structure as identified in VA's 2014 through 2020 strategic plan and through the MyVA Task Force. VA has been actively working on addressing organizational, policy, procedural, perceptual, and cultural boundaries that could constrain our ability to coordinate, integrate, and deliver benefits and services. We appreciate the committee's attention on the critical topic of VA strategic planning and are eager to continue to discuss these efforts with the committee. Mr. Chairman, at this time, the department does not have views on H.R. 280. We note that this legislation could change laws and policies beyond that of our department and as such, we are consulting with other federal government agencies. We will continue to coordinate views on this matter and upon completion, submit them to the committee. Finally, we cannot support H.R. 245 because its primary purpose appears to be to overrule VA's recent rulemaking and maintain the concept of informal claims. It would codify current rules that make it difficult to identify claims and unintentionally incentivize submission of claims in non-standard formats that frustrate timely, accurate, and orderly claim processing. Our final rule, which is effective on March 24th, is crucial to VA's long-term efforts to modernize the claim system for the benefit of all veterans. It would eliminate the concept of informal claims and replace it with submission of claims in a format more amenable to efficient processing while still allowing veterans to receive favorable effective date treatment similar to what is available today under current rules. Also, to process veterans' claims for benefits as accurately and efficiently as possible, VA is moving towards a paperless electronic system. An important component of that transition is that claims must originate on standardized inputs that can be easily identified and contain the core data needed to process the claim. We believe that the final rule carefully and comprehensively balances the interests of modernizing the VA claim system with allowing claimants to easily initiate claims and preserve the most favorable effective dates. VA strongly opposes H.R. 245 because it would run counter to VA's efforts to assist veterans by improving the efficiency of the claims process and would impair our ability to achieve and maintain our backlog reduction. Mr. Chairman, this concludes my statement. We are happy to entertain any questions that you or the members of the committee may have. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and thank all the folks for being here today. I've got a couple issues. I want to, Mr. McClinican, talk about H.R. 280, which is the bonus rescission bill, but I want to ask in a few questions about the current status, if you will, of the 2014 bonus of former director of the Phoenix VA Medical Center, Ms. Sharon Hellman, that was, according to the department, given in error. It's my understanding that the recoupment of her bonus from 2013 has stopped because Ms. Hellman has attempted to appeal the recoupment to VA's Debt Management Center. Could you tell the committee, please, what is the status of her appeal? And under VA's policy, what happens if she loses this appeal now that she's no longer an employee of the department?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I will defer to Ms. McLeod to provide you a response to that question.
Mr. Chairman, right now, once Ms. Hellman requested an appeal of the offset of her salary or the debt that she incurred, any offset on her salary had to be stopped, and she was entitled to a hearing on that debt. That hearing goes before a third-party United States Postal Service ALJ, who will hear her request and will make a decision based on her request. So at this time, the VA is waiting to find out what the ALJ has done.
If she loses her appeal, how do you recoup the bonus that was given in error?
If she loses her appeal, we will issue a debt like we already did, and we will continue to receive the money back.
But she no longer receives a salary from the department. That's how you were doing it. You were recouping it by taking it out of her current salary. So what is the mechanism then that VA has to recoup that debt?
A debt will be issued, and that will go to the essentially Treasury Department, who will recoup that like they would recoup any debt from a citizen, even though she's no longer employed by the VA.
Retirement pay?
I'm not sure, but I can take that back and bring
is,
that back.
Is, am, you've taken no formal position on H.R. 280, but I'd like to know if, in fact, the Secretary, if it's correct that the Secretary does not have the authority to rescind a bonus once it is given. Is that correct?
We have a very limited authority right now. To the extent an administrative error occurs, the agency can recoup money based on an administrative error. We have no other formal process to recoup performance awards.
What happens if there's criminal activity and somebody's charged with a crime? Does the VA then have the ability to go back and recoup a bonus?
Not that I'm aware of, but we could certainly take that back and get back to the committee.
Would that be an appropriate tool for the VA to have? Because it appears from press reports and information that we've gathered that a crime may have been committed, and it's stunning to me that the VA does not have the ability to go in and recoup a bonus if a crime has been committed.
I'm not able to answer that for the department at this point.
Okay, thank you very much. One question about H.R. 245. Mr. McLenican, one of the VSOs presented a note in their written testimony that the rulemaking suggests there would be a change in VA's treatment of inferred claims, that is, claims reasonably raised by the contents of a veteran's record. Previously, if a veteran had a condition secondary to a condition claimed or even an unrelated condition that could be reasonably raised by the record, the veteran would be entitled to service connection if a nexus to his service was found. Under the rulemaking set to take effect in March, it appears it would not. This system, I would hope, is supposed to be pro-veteran, and I want to pose a hypothetical. You can answer, hopefully, whether or not VA would adjudicate this claim under the rules. A veteran files a formal claim for an elbow disability, which he alleges is due to a fall he suffered while in boot camp. The veteran scheduled for a VA examination to assess his elbow disability and arrives for the exam in a wheelchair, and it's clearly evident that both of the veteran's legs have been amputated. The military service records in the veteran's VA file reflect that the veteran was injured in an explosive blast during a deployment to Afghanistan and sustained a traumatic injury to both legs, for which he received a Purple Heart. Under the new rulemaking, would the VA adjudicate a claim for the right and left leg disabilities if the veteran only formally filed for his elbow condition?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I think there may be a misunderstanding regarding the final rule that we issued. We did not propose a policy change in this particular area. We currently adjudicate all claims to include secondary matters and ancillary benefits that arise that are within the scope of the claim that's filed. So we did not propose a change to that. What was in the final rule is intended merely as a clarification regarding current policy. To directly answer your question, if it is determined at that examination and in adjudication of the claim that the conditions that were noted were within the scope of the claim that was filed, we would adjudicate that as a claim that's pending. Yes.
Thank you. Ms. Brown?
I just have one quick question, Ms. McLeod, I guess. Do you know whether any of the federal agencies at this time have the authority to recoup bonuses?
And to my knowledge, no other federal agencies have that power to do that.
But my time, I had no other questions. And I don't think anyone else on my side had any questions. No one else in the minority have a question.
Thank you much. Mr. Lamborn.
Thank you. And also in connection with Ranking Member Brown's bill, I'd like to ask, will the future year's veteran program be made available online to the public? I know it's discussed internally within the VA, and that's for any one of you.
Good morning. With the current legislation, it doesn't specify whether that's publicly available or not. The similar programs in Department of Defense and DHS do not provide those publicly. They do provide them to the Congress. I would assume that this would be implemented the same way.
Well, what if the bill isn't passed?
For
whatever reason.
The programming, the Future Years Veteran Plan, is an internal tool, and I would remain as an internal tool. It informs our budget process, but is, you know, separate from that. So we would continue to use it in that manner.
So the only way it would be made available to the public would be if this legislation were to pass, under current VA policy?
Under current policy, yes.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Ms. Brownlee, no questions? Dr. Benishek?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I guess I don't understand what is the objection to H.R. 216 by the VA. I mean, what it seems to me this is, we'd like to have a transparency in this process of planning for the budget in the VA. What is the downside?
Thank you for your interest in strategic planning and department. We do support the intent of the bill. We are right now evolving a lot of our processes, the planning, programming, budgeting, and execution process. We're in our fourth year of going through that cycle. The objection is, we think that it's too early to codify it in statute. We'd really like to get the processes a little bit more mature before we know what's really going to work in the long term. So we are doing all of pretty much everything that's in H.R. 216. It's the matter of how it's officially codified, giving us the ability to continue to mature those processes over time.
Is there some reason that we shouldn't be aware of what you're doing? I just don't understand the reasoning. I mean, that's not a very good answer, as far as I can tell, Ms. Sullivan, as to why Ms. Brown's idea of making sure that we're all aware of what's going on is a bad idea. And I just don't understand your answer. I mean, we expect it to change with time. So I just don't understand that objection, but I guess that's the answer that we have. I guess I'll yield back the remainder of my time. Thank you.
Mr. Custer? Dr. Abraham.
Yes, questions for Mr. McClanahan. Your written testimony does represent VA's adamant opposition to H.R. 245, which in pertinent part seeks to preserve the ability of veterans to establish dates of claim at the point where the veteran opts to pursue a disability claim. One of our present stakeholders has noted in written testimony that VA's recent rulemaking on standard claims and appeals forms will, quote, create a division between veterans with internet access and those without internet access. You've also noted that VA, quote, receives an enormous volume, end quote, of informal claims. Considering the opposition to your rulemaking by the several VSOs present today, I find it difficult to overlook the fact that VA, through its rulemaking process, sought to unilaterally roll back decades worth of pro-veteran policy regarding establishment of effective dates. This is a ploy to make the VA's job easier and has the effect of taking monetary benefits from veterans who have earned them. Please explain how you can possibly describe your rulemaking as, quote, maintaining a pro-veteran process that is acceptable, end quote, when you will be making it harder for so many veterans to use your words, quote, an enormous volume, end quote, of veterans without internet access to establish an effective date at the point where the veteran opts to pursue a disability claim.
Thank you, sir, for that, for the question, and I'm glad I have an opportunity to address this concern. I want to be very frank with the committee that this was an opportunity to demonstrate to you how the rulemaking process can really work to help veterans at the same time as helping VA. I assure you this is not a ploy by VA in any way. When we issued our proposed rule, what we did is we proposed to incentivize the filing of electronic claims through our e-benefits system. That's what we initially proposed to do. And in the rulemaking process, we received comments saying, essentially, you're moving too fast. The primary concerns were that we were treating, just as you just suggested, and we were treating paper claims differently than electronic claims, and we hadn't accounted for that. and we were not providing the same effective rate treatment for paper claims as electronic claims. So what we did is we completely revamped the rule. What we proposed is not in our final rule. What's in our final rule is that we treat paper claims exactly the same as electronic claims for effective date purposes. Secondly, we removed informal claims, but what we really did is we replaced it simply with, as one of the commenters suggested, why don't you just come up with a standard informal claim form? That's essentially what we did, sir. We have an intent to file form, which is a one-page document that does exactly the same thing as informal claims today. It's just that it's on a standard form. And I submit to each and every one of the members of the committee that your constituents deal with standard forms every day of their lives in every situation where they encounter private and public entities, just not at VA. And so when we talk about striking the proper balance, sir, we really believe that we've done that in the rulemaking process. We've maintained the informal claim process through what we're now calling intent to file, a one-page document, can be submitted in three different ways, and this is how you address the issue of people that don't have internet access. We have gone so far as to make it even more liberal to file an intent to file form. The reason is, under current law, you have to identify the disability, your symptoms. That's required by a court case, and we implemented that in our regulations. Well, under the new regulations, we are not going to do that. All you have to do on this form is three things. Tell us whether you want compensation, pension, or a survivor's benefit. Two, provide us your identifying information. And three, sign the form, either you or your representative. And that will establish your effective date. Three ways you can do it. You can pick up the phone and call one of our call centers. You can walk into one of our offices, and somebody will fill out the form for you. Third, you can start an electronic claim, and when you start that electronic claim, it preserves the effective date for you. So to address all of those concerns, sir, that you just mentioned, we did that in the final rule. So the only thing that is left is there is a one-page standard form. We essentially did what the commenter said, create a form for informal claims, and that's what we did. So that really strikes that balance that you mentioned, sir, when you were describing your bill, was the balance between allowing VA to easily identify claims and quickly process them versus spending resources needlessly trying to figure out whether something is a claim or not.
But what you've done is you've converted that informal claim all of a sudden to a standardized formal document, and that resets the time clock for this veteran.
Sir, it does the same thing as current rules for informal claims. It establishes an effective date. So you come into us and you say, I want to apply for compensation. And if you walk in, we have an employee that's going to sit there and type that information in for you. It establishes in our systems, and you get the same effective date that you would get under the informal claims process. There is absolutely no difference. The only distinction is it's either a walk-in on submitted on the standard paper form, or you start it electronically.
How long will it take the VA then to respond or process that informal claim on the standardized form once they get it?
Whether we're talking about informal claims today or intent to file under the new rules, that is not a claim. What happens is that preserves the effective date if the claimant comes in within a year and files a claim.
And if they receive an informal letter?
No, we have a statutory obligation when we receive an informal claim, and we will under the intent to file process. We have a statutory obligation to provide the claimant the application form. So let's assume that you call the call center and you say, I want to file for compensation. The call center logs in that intent to file, it preserves your effective date, and we have an obligation to send the proper application form and tell the claimant everything they have to do to complete that application. That's a statutory obligation today, and it will be under the final rule.
I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Rice, do you have any questions? I have one quick one. In your testimony, you said the primary intent of this bill appears to be to overrule VA's current rulemaking.
Yes, sir.
Does it offend you that Congress would attempt to overrule your rulemaking?
No, sir, not at all. And And let me just suggest to...
That's all I needed, was just a yes or no. It appeared that you might have your feathers ruffled just a little bit, and I didn't want that to be the case. Mr. Costello is gone. Mr. Bost is gone. Dr. Winstrup.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. McClinican, I understand that the department has some issues with 294, H.R. 294, some technical issues with that, and you might have some suggestions for us on that Long-Term Veterans Choice Act. And I think we all look forward to discussing some of those technicalities with you. But really what I'm asking today is, will you give us the assurance that you will work with us in a very timely fashion on those and on any technical corrections you may have so that we can move forward in a very timely fashion?
Yes, Dr. Jane has a particular interest in doing that with you, so I'll let him address it.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Congressman, for that question. And I really want to thank Chairman Miller for really authoring this bill and also for the committee for considering it. These are minor issues in some ways, but they could be challenging, and we really want this program to function really well for our veterans. For example, there is a term used in the bill for transfer to homes, and for many clinicians that could mean that this will require an admission to a hospital bed before the veteran becomes eligible for this benefit. So rather than being directly admitted from the veteran's home to the foster home. So that's just one issue. The other issue is the word contracts, and we believe that there are some of our foster home operators that may have challenges with the contracting process. It can be pretty lengthy and complicated. So if there's a way to tweak some of that language, those are the only issues that we're talking about.
You mean a simpler contract of some type? Is that
or perhaps defining the agreements a little bit better, but I will defer to my counsel to maybe be able to clarify that issue.
Thank you, Doctor.
We'd have to take that back and bring it back to the committee, but we're happy to work with you all on that.
Well, I appreciate it. Thank you, and I yield back.
Dr. Ruiz, do you have any questions? Mr. Bilirakis, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate it. Mr. McClinican, I want to get back to H.R. 216, Ms. Brown's bill. I want to follow up on Dr. Banaschik's questions. Again, the VA indicates its support for the principles and concepts of H.R. 216, but is hesitant to embrace looking those principles in statute. And again, I want to give you another opportunity. Why not in statute with respect to the legislation's requirement for VA to submit resource estimates over a five-year horizon that are aligned with the department's goals and objectives for various programs? What is the problem with embracing the concept in statute if you agree with it in principle? And again, DOD does it. Why not the VA?
I'll defer to Ms. Sullivan on that because she's really the expert in this area.
Okay. Ms. Sullivan, please.
Again, thank you in general for the support for the concept in the bill. We're still kind of working on it. DOD has had decades to put that process in place, work the process, and make sure everybody understands the pieces. We're in our fourth year. I think we need to work more and come and give you more information on what that process is and the types of things that we're working through. There's several areas in the bill. The programming, the Future Year Veterans Plan is one. Some of the issues there or the concerns are putting that together with the budget. Those are two separate processes. We don't want to confuse the two or constrain future budgets from what's in the five-year plan. Some of the other areas, looking at the quadrennial review, what that looks like for VA is very different from what that looks like for DOD or DHS. We actually take their quadrennial reviews as input to us. So there are some pieces on how we look at how those processes in those other departments really apply to VA.
Okay, well, would you agree to work with Ms. Brown on this particular issue? I mean, accountability is so very important. These are taxpayer dollars. Ms. Brown is my fellow Floridian, and we care about our veterans first. So Would you agree to work with her and possibly invite me to the meeting as well? Because I think we need to get this done for our veterans.
Absolutely. Happy to work with the committee.
All right, very good. Thank you. I yield back.
Ms. Sullivan, you said you've been working on it for 4 years. Do you think that putting the force of law behind it might encourage you to move a little quicker in establishing what Ms. Brown is trying to accomplish?
For some of these, they are annual processes, so it's still just going to take one cycle per year. We really can't go any faster. We did do a lot with the strategic plan that we developed that came out in last year in 2014, and we will start on our next cycle for the strategic plan. Again, that's a four-year cycle in itself. Obviously, anything in legislation is going to get attention. I don't know if that will help mature the process any faster.
I hope it would. If it's in law, I would hope that it would encourage you to move quicker. I think Ms. Brown's got a great idea, and it's something that everybody on this committee can get behind and support. I mean, we give you enough time to do it without putting it in law, and you still come forward opposing, agreeing with the concept, but opposing putting it in statute. And it's hard for some of us to understand that. Mr. Kaufman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. McLeod, on House Bill 280, it's my understanding that the Secretary McDonald has no position on that right now. Excuse me, that bill right now, am I correct in that?
That is correct.
Okay, can you, that really surprises me, because he came on board to clean up the VA from the scandals of its past that seem to continue to this day. And so if I understand the bill right, first of all, in your testimony earlier, you made the statement that VA's only ability to claw back a bonus is if there's an error in that it shouldn't be administrated, it was never authorized or for the amount that it was authorized for. Am I correct in that?
Essentially, sir, yes. The only ability right now is a very narrow one when there has been an administrative error committed.
So we've had incidents that are well known today in our hospital, in the VHA system, where management was complicit in a cover-up involving appointment wait times. And those same managers were given bonuses based on false reporting of performance, where veterans suffered from that. Then in the situation in my district, where we have a hospital, the half bill, hundreds of millions of dollars over budget, years behind schedule, along with other hospitals that have some of the same problems that are currently being built, major construction projects by the VA, the individual in charge of those projects within the leadership of the Veterans Administration received over $60,000 in bonuses since 2009, Glenn Hagstrom. So, you know, clearly he didn't meet the criteria of the goals that were established. And so what you're saying is there's no mechanism under current law to claw back bonuses from somebody who clearly didn't meet when new information comes out, and they clearly didn't meet the goals that were expressed as a requirement to get the bonus, or criminal conduct was committed during that period of time, that there's no mechanism to claw back in current law that bonus. And I'm correct in that, right?
You're correct.
And so we have a Secretary of the Veterans Affairs that can't make a decision on something so obvious. I think it's just extraordinary. And what it says to me and what it says to the veterans of this country is nothing's really changed. Nothing's really changed in the Department of Veterans Affairs. And I want you to take the message back to the Secretary that he ought to make a decision on that. And the decision ought to be to support this bill. I yield back.
Thank you. Ms. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I do have a question for Ms. Sullivan. I'm a little confused. Did I hear you correctly that you're concerned with forward protection separate from the budget?
I'm sorry, can you repeat the question?
Concerned with keeping the forward year protections separate from the budgetary process?
So the five-year look at the resource allocation is a tool that informs the budget. There is some concern if those are both out together that those future year projections would set expectations for future year budgets and not provide some of the flexibility to deal with emerging priorities. So almost setting that in stone for the 5 years out and not being able to go through the budget formulation process.
Well, I think that's what we want. We want to know what are the plans.
But as a plan, as long as it's able to then be adjusted during the budget cycle, not laying for us to see 5 years in the future and lay that kind of in stone, it's a planning tool to look at those outward projections, but not something that, again, the perception that that would then be the budget for that future year. There still is the budget process as a
separate
process.
Why wouldn't you be able to adjust it if it's just a planning tool?
We would. I think the look now is whether or not those that are receiving it are able to, you know, kind of give us that flexibility as we go into the budget formulation cycle to look back and say, well, 4 years ago you said it was going to be this, and now you're coming in with this budget. So again, it's a planning tool. It informs the budget.
But I understand that. But as you planned, different factors come. Maybe we get additional veterans in certain categories, or you know, it's lots of factors that's going to affect it. But I think what we're trying to do is to see your roadmap, so that we can have some idea as to your planning process also.
Understand.
Well, we clearly need to get together.
Ms. Sullivan, if I could follow up on what Ms. Brown was just acting, shouldn't Congress have the ability to look at year 2, 3, 4, and 5 to help determine how you arrived at the current budget year request? Again, what is the fear that VA has to putting a five-year plan out to the public?
Some of that, I have to take back some of the details, but again, the other departments who do this, that is not public information. We're trying to, you know, look at similar processes to DOD and DHS. We obviously share our strategic plan and our planning processes. We do consult with Congress and the VSOs on doing that.
I serve on the Armed Services Committee, and we get a five-year budget picture. I just don't understand what VA's problem is with giving Congress the information on which you base your current year's budget proposal on.
At this point, we're still maturing that process. I don't know if it's...
How long will that process take to become mature?
Can't answer that. I'm sorry. I'll have to take that back.
Okay. I'd like an answer.
Okay.
I think it would be... Ms. Radawagon. Do you have any questions?
No, I don't, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Ms. Brown, Chairman, one final question.
Thank you.
We'll go to the third panel.
My understanding, NASA does the forward budget, and they make theirs public.
I'll have to look into that. Thank you.
We advance appropriations. We do it. And, you know, I was very involved and very instrumental in making sure that VA got advanced appropriations. But I think what we're saying is we want to be a part of that planning process.
Appreciate that. And yes, we'll come and meet with you and provide some more information and work with you on that.
Thank you. Are you back?
Yeah, I think it would be a good idea that we have you come back and talk with the entire committee about Ms. Brown's legislation. I think we'd all be interested in knowing where the fear is from VA with making those numbers available to Congress. I want to thank you all for being here today, and we've got a third panel. So second panel is excused, and I'd invite our third panel to please come to the witness table. As they're coming forward, joining us today is Mr. Joe Violante, National Legislative Director for Disabled American Veterans. Alex Murawski, Deputy Director of the National Legislative Service of the Veterans of Foreign Wars of the United States, Mr. Zachary Hearn, Deputy Director for Claims of the Veterans Affairs and Rehabilitation Commission for the American Legion, and Mr. Blake Ortner, the Deputy Director of Government Relations for Paralyzed Veterans of America. I appreciate you all being here. All of your complete written statements will be made a part of the record. And Mr. Violante, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Brown, members of the committee, DOV appreciates the opportunity to testify before this committee on the various bills under consideration. H.R. 216 would establish new planning and budgetary processes and make changes affecting VA's ability to develop and implement budgets and strategic plans. The bill directs the Secretary to submit to Congress a future year's veterans program and a quadrennial veterans review modeled on similar procedures for DOD and Homeland Security. The legislation would also establish the new position of Chief Strategic Officer. Mr. Chairman, for decades, DAV and our partners in the independent budget have pointed out mismatches in funding for VA programs, which became evident in last year's scheduling scandal and access crisis. This legislation would help to address this problem by adding more transparency and rigor to VA's budget and planning process. DAV generally supports this legislation, although we do have a few concerns. First, the legislation must make clear that both the quadrennial review and the future year's veterans program are made publicly available when they are delivered to Congress. Second, the bill gives OMB some ability to constrain VA's planning by setting guidance on the overall resources available to VA. It is vital that any long-range strategic planning process produce honest assessments of veterans' needs and the cost to meet them. Third, the bill does not make clear how the Chief Strategy Officer will interact with VA's Chief Financial Officer or the undersecretaries. This might add a new dimension of bureaucracy that could complicate rather than improve budgeting. Finally, we are concerned about the potential of diminishing the influence of veteran stakeholders when setting out VA's long-term missions and priorities. H.R. 245 would reestablish certain safeguards for veterans who currently file informal claims. Under a VA rule that will take effect in March, claimants will no longer be able to file informal claims through written communications, establishing only an intent to file a claim process that must be completed on standardized forms. As a result, veterans may lose some accrued benefits. The bill seeks to remedy this situation by requiring that claimants who send written communications to VA indicating an intent to file a claim would be considered an informal claim and would have up to 180 days to complete the required forms to protect their effective date. DAV supports the purpose of this provision. However, we strongly recommend that the informal claim period be restored to a full year, same as the new intent to file a claim procedure, to ensure that all veterans who file claims are treated equitably regardless of how they file them. DAV supports H.R. 294. Some severely disabled veterans who are unable to live independently at home choose to reside in more intimate, home-like alternatives to a nursing home called medical foster homes. While some veterans cannot afford medical foster homes, other veterans who can are required by law to pay the full cost of their own pockets. Many of them are service-connected veterans who could choose to live in a more expensive nursing home setting fully paid for by VA. This measure would give VA a 3-year authority to pay for veterans who want to reside in a VA-approved medical foster home, saving taxpayers money. However, despite the laudable aim of this measure, we do not believe its goals will be successfully achieved unless Congress fixes VA's authority to use provider agreements, since VA currently is unable to use its Provider Agreements Authority to pay for medical foster homes, the alternative is to use contract vehicles. Because of the burdensome reporting and auditing requirements inherent in federal contracting, we believe some medical foster home providers would not be willing or capable of entering into complex contracts with VA. We urge the committee to pass these bills, and we pledge to work with you and your staff to address our concerns. That concludes my testimony, and I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much. Mr. Morosky, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, on behalf of the men and women of the Veterans of Foreign Wars of the United States and our auxiliaries, I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to testify in today's pending legislation. The Service Member Foreclosure Protection Extension Act. The VFW supports this legislation, which would continue for 1 year, the extension of the period that veterans are protected from mortgage sale or foreclosure following their military service from 9 to 12 months. The VFW believes that veterans should be afforded the maximum opportunity to gain financial stability when transitioning from active duty to civilian life without the threat of losing their homes. A January 2014 GAO report found that military borrowers were at a higher risk of mortgage delinquency in the first year after leaving active service. But with these protections in place, we're more likely to resolve those delinquencies than others. Accordingly, the VFW believes that the one-year protection window should not only be extended, but we urge Congress to make this policy permanent. The Department of Veterans Affairs Budget Planning Reform Act. This legislation would require VA to estimate and report to Congress its budgetary needs for 4 fiscal years. It would also establish a quadrennial veterans review to ensure VA has a strategy to meet the future needs of our nation's veterans. The VFW strongly agrees that VA should constantly analyze veterans' needs and develop a strategy that will enable it to address such needs, not just today and tomorrow, but for years to come. The quadrennial review concept has been successful for DOD in prioritizing its strategic pillars to ensure it's able to protect America and advance our interests abroad. The VFW supports the concept of a quadrennial veterans review, but we do not believe VA should prioritize veterans' benefits. VA benefits and programs are vital to the veterans they serve. One benefit is not more important than the other and should not be treated as such. Instead, we suggest the quadrennial review analyze the fiscal demands of the full range of programs and capabilities. This would ensure VA adjusts its programs to fit emerging trends and maximizes its finite resources to meet veterans' needs. The bill would also require VA to conduct a study to ensure its functions and organizational structure are effective, efficient, and economical. The VFW applauds Secretary Robert McDonald for realizing that VA's organizational structure needs to change. In November, he announced the MyVA initiative to, among other things, reorganize the department's structure to better meet veterans' needs. VFW believes the VA should be given the opportunity to fully implement Secretary McDonald's reorganizational initiative before a study is commissioned. H.R. 245. This bill makes two significant changes. First, the bill codifies the effective date for a claim to include the date VA receives an informal claim. This is a much-needed provision that will provide clear understanding for a claimant's effective date of claim. The second provision places a 180-day time limitation on veterans who have filed an informal claim to complete and return VA Form 21-526 to VA. The VFW opposes this provision. Current law provides claimants a full year to complete and return application form under other circumstances. The VFW believes there should be parity between existing law and this proposal and recommends that claimants are afforded a full year to submit their formal claim. This does not place an additional burden on VA and will not count towards the time the claim takes to be adjudicated. H.R. 280. VFW supports this legislation. Employees receive bonuses as incentive and recognition for superior work performance. But if a bonus is found after the fact to be awarded to an employee who manipulated data, put veterans at risk of harm, or in some other way defrauded the government to receive that bonus, the Secretary should have the authority to recoup the bonus amount. The Long-Term Care Veterans Choice Act. The VFW supports this legislation, which would allow enrolled veterans in nursing home care to transfer into adult foster home care at their request. Currently, veterans who choose to live in adult foster homes must do so at their own expense. To grant VA the authority to reimburse adult foster homes would provide veterans with an additional residency choice, potentially improving the quality of life for those who would prefer this option. The VFW strongly believes that all non-VA care services should be provided in conjunction with proper care coordination. The VHA Medical Foster Home Procedures Handbook requires an interdisciplinary VA home care team to provide the veteran with primary care, regularly communicate with the foster home caregiver, and monitor the care provided with frequent unannounced visits. The VFW feels that these would ensure adequate care coordination and recommends that the care coordination policies outlined in that document should be made permanent by adding them to the language of this legislation. Mr. Chairman, this concludes my statement, and I'll be happy to answer any questions you or other members of the committee may have.
Thank you very much. Mr. Hearn, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you. Good morning, Chairman Miller, Ranking Member Brown, and members of the committee. On behalf of National Commander Helm and the 2.4 million members of the American Legion, we are honored to speak this morning regarding proposed bills impacting our nation's veterans. Based on the slate of bills for consideration, the American Legion supports the following bills: H.R. 189, the Service Member Foreclosure Protection Act of 2015, H.R. 216, the Department of Veterans Affairs Budget Planning and Reform Act of 2015, H.R. 245, H.R. 280. H.R. 289 addresses alternative solutions to veterans incapable of independent living. Currently, the American Legion does not have a position pertaining to this bill. However, we are continuing to consider the solutions the bill provides. A complete discussion of the American Legion's position can be found in our written testimony that you have before you today. The American Legion supports H.R. 245. In recent years, the Veterans Benefits Administration has taken steps to improve its efficiency in the adjudication of claims. One much publicized effort was the virtual transformation in the claims process. Another effort was the VA's issuance of regulations that would change a decades-old policy regarding the submission of informal claims. The American Legion opposes this change. Historically, veterans were permitted to submit written correspondence to VA indicating their intent to file a claim for disability benefits. This process did not require a specified form. It simply required a written communication indicating a desire to file for disability benefits for a particular condition. In September 2014, VA issued regulations that would go into effect in March 2015 that would eliminate the informal written claim as a marker for an effective date of benefits. Instead, veterans were directed to submit claims electronically, orally to a VA employee, or through a new VA form to protect the earliest possible effective date. Veterans who name the benefit they seek in a written communication to the VA are punished because that communication under the new regulations would not protect the earliest effective date. What really is happening is that the VBA is using the new regulations to artificially reduce the number of pending claims. It is counterintuitive for veterans to not mention the benefit that they seek. Compelling veterans to file via electronic means could be detrimental. The National Center for Veterans Analysis and Statistics reported the average male veteran was 64 years old in 2011. And the Census Bureau reports that less than half of Americans over 65 years old have access to the internet. If a sizable portion of the veteran population does not have regular access to the means necessary to file an incomplete application, is VA adequately serving the veteran population? It should be mentioned that the issue of expediency on the front end of the claims process isn't the only reason why VA pursued this policy. Another justification for this process was that a number of inferred claims hadn't been recognized by VA at the regional offices. It was only when a claim was appealed to the Board of Veterans Appeals that a BVA judge recognized the nature of the claim. VA's requirement for the standardized form suggests that instead of embracing its responsibility to properly train its employees, VA opted to abdicate its responsibility to both its employees and the veteran community through removing the policy altogether. Ultimately, VA's policy pertaining to the electronic submission of claims will have a deleterious effect upon effective dates. If veterans, regardless of age, do not have access to the internet, then they may have to endure additional steps to file a claim, losing their effective date, and ultimately the payment of their disability benefits. H.R. 245 codifies a longstanding practice of VA permitting informal claims without the requirement of a standardized form or electronic submission. Moreover, it permits veterans to maximize the benefits earned through their dedicated service to this nation. Again, on behalf of National Commander Helm and 2.4 million members that comprise the American Legion, we thank the committee for hearing our testimony today, and I'll be happy to answer any questions that this committee may have.
Thank you, Mr. Hearn. Mr. Ortner, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Chairman Miller, Ranking Member Brown, and members of the committee, Paralyzed Veterans of America would like to thank you for the opportunity to testify today on legislation before the committee. PVA supports H.R. 189. It is our belief that the extension of this foreclosure protection should have been included with other extenders that were passed in the 113th Congress and was inadvertently left out. PVA generally supports the intent. However, we have concerns regarding H.R. 216, similar to those expressed in 2013 when PVA testified on similar draft legislation. This legislation establishes new planning and budgeting processes, as well as study and make organizational changes affecting VA's ability to develop and implement budgets and strategic plans. Our concerns are similar to those expressed by the panel today. Long-range strategic planning is vitally important, and VA does and must continue to do this. VA annually prepares and submits to Congress and the public a performance and accountability report to show how well VA's strategic goals are being met. In addition, VA's annual budget submission lays out in great detail the programs and policies designed to achieve VA's strategic goals. VA also supports 24 ongoing advisory committees to provide outside perspective, and Congress has authorized commissions and task forces to look at major issues. It is not yet clear how or if the creation of the Quadrennial Veterans Review would improve on these ongoing strategic planning processes. Similarly, it is not clear whether the creation of a future year's veterans program would lead to either more transparent or more accurate budgets or appropriations. And based on Ms. Sullivan's testimony, transparency does not appear to be a goal. There are also questions about the creation of the new Chief Strategy Officer. The language of the legislation gives the CSO significant independence in overseeing all planning and programming throughout VA. Would the CSO have overlapping authority with the undersecretaries? How would the CSO and the CFO interact during preparation of VA's budget? Are they co-equal, and how would disagreements between them be settled? Would this lead to greater harmony or conflict within VA's budget formulation process? We also have questions about the role of veteran service organizations in the development of the QVR. As organizations with great experience and expertise in dealing with veterans, will this board consultation process dilute our input? VSOs are not idle stakeholders. We are concerned about putting us on par with less interested, informed, and involved stakeholders during the consultation process. Although we do have questions about this legislation, I want to emphasize we have no questions about the sincere intentions and aims of the sponsors of this legislation. PVA supports H.R. 245 to codify existing provisions of law relating to effective dates of claims, in particular, the informal claim procedures. Because veterans may not realize the intricacies of claiming benefits, some may submit claims on their own, which might simply consist of a letter presenting their case. PVA welcomes provisions requiring the Secretary to provide a claims application form when the informal claim is received, but agree that the informal claim continue with the same weight of law, unbiased consideration, and receipt date had it been a formal claim. PVA is not opposed to provisions of H.R. 280 and believes giving the Secretary some kind of leverage to hold senior staff more accountable is valuable. However, it is critical that the Secretary not enjoy any sort of carte blanche authority to strip bonuses. Concerning the time frame, PVA does not believe that this authority should continue in perpetuity, but be of sufficient length to ensure that behavior discovered in the future can be acted upon. Let us also be very clear, we do not feel that this limit should apply in cases of clear fraud or criminal activity. A second concern regards the rights of the employee for a review of the recoupment. PVA is not certain a hearing with the Secretary is the best or most fair venue for the review, as it would establish the Secretary as an arbiter of his or her own decision. PVA generally supports H.R. 294 regarding the transfer of veterans to non-VA adult foster homes. PVA believes that VA's primary obligation involving long-term support services is to provide veterans with quality medical care in a healthy and safe environment. It is PVA's position that adult foster homes are only appropriate for disabled veterans who do not require regular monitoring by licensed providers, but rather have a catastrophic injury or disability and are able to sustain a high level of independence. When these veterans are transferred to adult foster homes, care coordination with VA specialized systems of care is vital, and the veteran must be regularly evaluated by specialized providers trained to meet the needs of their specific conditions. Mr. Chairman, this concludes my statement, and I would be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Ortner, very much. And I'd like to go ahead and yield for questions to the chairman of the committee, subcommittee, Dr. Abraham.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Ortner. Your testimony on H.R. 245 noted that as VA tries to reduce its claims backlog, there is a risk that the department will look for methods to avoid claims that are difficult to complete. And I'm very concerned by the state of affairs as difficult claims, in quotation marks, may be those of our most serious, severely disabled veterans. Would you elaborate, please, on this concern that you and I share, a bit more about how the 2015 goal to eliminate the claims backlog may actually create reverse incentives for VBA to strategize methods to avoid hard claims?
Yes, sir. I think, and I think in our full testimony, we discussed a little bit about the concerns of both trying to avoid some of those claims that are possibly more difficult, and the informal claim is one of those that you definitely run into a problem with because of the requirement to collect the evidence. Probably of greater concern is the risk of those claims being pushed off, as we discussed in hearing last week, having to do with becoming grounds for more appeals. So I think that's our concern. I think the stress or the sort of Damocles hanging over the heads regarding the 2015 requirements can potentially push people into trying to speed things along or trying to avoid those issues that may complicate them meeting that goal.
Thank you. One more question. Mr. Vellante, your testimony recommend that the informal claim period be expanded beyond that which is currently set forth in H.R. 245 and extend to a full year. Tell me again why your organization believes that full year is necessary as opposed to the 180 days?
Well, currently the law allows for 1 year for a veteran to file it. Under their proposed rule change that VA has, they would also allow 1 year from the intent to file a claim for a veteran to file his formal appeal. So we believe, number one, 1 year gives a veteran sufficient time. There's a lot of medical problems sometimes that arise that keep them from filing these claims. But it would also keep the same time that's in place now, as well as what VA intends to do with their intent to file.
Thank you. I have one other question. Mr. Hearn, good to see you again. You're on the subcommittee. Your testimony on H.R. 245 noted that the American Legion does not agree with the department's rulemaking as it regards to inferred claims. Did the American Legion state its opinion to the VA during the rulemaking process? And if so, to what extent did dialogue occur on these concerns?
The period to comment, I think it opened up in late 2013. The American Legion submitted their comments regarding this issue. I believe it was the end, I think December 31st was the deadline to submit the comments pertaining to this. We've had our concerns about this going back over the last 12 months. I have a copy of those comments if you would like to see them. But the VSOs were open and VA allowed for these comments to be made, and right from the very beginning we had concerns, and we had very sincere concerns regarding this, and regardless VA continued to move down the path.
I yield back.
Ms. Brown.
Yes, Ms. Brownlee has a question.
Ms. Brownlee.
Yes, just quickly. I certainly agree with the argument that there should never be a rule that would prevent or delay in any way veterans from getting their benefits. And Mr. Hearn, you had, in your testimony, it seemed as though, and correct me from the other VSOs if I'm summarizing incorrectly, but it seems as though the issue for most VSOs is about the time frame. It's not necessarily about the standardized form. But Mr. Hearn, in your testimony, you do highlight the issue around the informal claim and not going to a standardized form, in addition to the not going 180 days, but going for the full year. So could you just describe to me, sort of in what form, how many informal claims are we getting from veterans at this particular point in time, and what do they sort of look like?
An informal claim, it can be submitted online paper, on any sort of document, just a level of written correspondence to VA indicating that there's an intent to file for a particular medical condition. As far as the numbers, I would have to go back and get those for you. But the problem with this is that it's there is a standardized form that's ultimately going to be submitted when a veteran files the formal claim aspect. It's maintaining the effective date that we have concerns. When this issue was first brought up, and VA had mentioned it today, that we use standardized forms and everything, which is correct, we do. And one of the what they pointed to so much was IRS. Well, tax season is just from January 1 through April 15. Veteran season is January 1 through December 31st. And so we can't set up tax prepare or veteran prepare operations in every strip mall and corner of America like you see during tax season. It's just not realistic. And we want to make sure that all veterans have access to receive those benefits that they receive. And our fear is that if we continue down this path that's been proposed, that those veterans' benefits are going to be reduced, if not eliminated.
Thank you. And I yield back.
Mr. Kaufman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a question for all the members of the panel. On H.R. 280, that involves the what we call the clawing back of bonuses that were given, either that where we find out that the recipient lacked merit for the bonus based on the record of performance after the fact that was found out, or that there was criminality involved during the duration that the bonus was given. What H.R. 280 does, it authorizes the Secretary of the VA to be able to claw back those bonuses. And right now, in the current law, it's only if, in fact, there was an administrative error in awarding the bonus that the only ability to claw back. Given the abuses that occurred in the VHA system with the appointment wait times, where there were instances where management was complicit in that and received bonuses for allegedly bringing down the wait times, which we know was at the expense of our veterans, or the construction of veterans' hospitals that are hundreds of millions of dollars over budget, years behind schedule, that the leadership involved in that received bonuses. I'd like to know if any of you have any reservations on the bill, or I'd like each one of you to state your position, organization to state your position on that legislation.
Congressman, DAV does not have an official position on that piece of legislation.
Congressman, the VFW supports the legislation. We feel like bonuses should be awarded for exceptional performance. Clearly, anybody who is putting veterans at risk, manipulating data, or defrauding the government is not performing exceptionally. And it's a disservice to the American taxpayer and veterans to allow them to keep their bonuses. So we support the legislation.
Congressman, the American Legion supports it. As many know, that we established Veterans Crisis Command Centers last year and went out into the field. And for those representatives of VA that essentially fraudulently received those bonuses, it's not right that they do it. Just as said earlier, these bonuses should be based upon merit, not off of manipulated data.
Congressman, the only real concerns PVA had with it is that time frame. Do we have a situation where somebody goes back 10 years, 12 years, and in our written testimony, we do indicate that we're not sure what that time frame should be. But that concern, and then also just the fact that the secretary is ruling on their own decision in a recruitment review. But other than that, we don't have any significant problems.
Mr. Ordner, I guess my question then would be to you then, but the decision's fairly subjective to begin with. The fact that there's criteria that is drawn up in terms of when someone merits a bonus. I mean, that's done by the leadership of the Veterans Committee. You and I assume you served in the military. Am I correct in that?
Yes, sir.
I don't know if people are going to get bonuses. I mean, unless they wanted to re-up for a longer period of time. But you were written up positively or negatively. And you were, and if you did a good job, you were promoted. If you didn't do a good job, you were demoted or relieved of command or whatever was relative to your position. And so here we have a problem of excessive bonuses for people not doing the work. And so, but what I sense in your position is some reservation about the secretary's ability to claw back those bonuses.
Actually, it's more of a reservation about the justification of the secretary in going back. I think in our discussion, there was a little concern, especially about the time frame. Do we have a secretary that attempts to recoup a bonus based on a policy disagreement, based on a political disagreement, or something like that, which is also why we go into the idea of saying if there's a case of fraud or criminal activity, obviously we, you know, that's a given. So that's really our reservation, is exactly what are the grounds for that, the bonus being recouped. And sir, you sort of backed up our concerns with saying, well, geez, it's kind of arbitrary on sometimes how those bonuses are given. So we don't want to get into a situation where it's arbitrary on how they're also pulled back due to some other disagreement.
Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kaufman. And I think if I'm correct, Brigadier General?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir. Any other comments or questions? Ms. Rice.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Ortner, do you have an estimate of how many veterans suffering from catastrophic injury or disability would actually be able to benefit from the Long-Term Care Veterans Choice Act?
No, ma'am, I don't, but I'd be happy to take that for the record and have our staff look into it.
That'd be great. And I just have a general question for all of you. In what ways are your organizations able to help veterans through this claims process to ensure that they get the benefits that they need?
DAV has a core of about 270 national service officers, and about 34 transition service officers. We're located at all the VA regional offices, as well as some of the military bases where military members are coming out. So we're available to them at those offices. We also have roughly about 2,000 service officers out in the field with chapters and departments that are points of contact that refer them to our national service officers.
Congresswoman, the VFW has similar services. We have service officers at each VA regional office. We have representatives at military bases for the benefits at discharge system, and we provide those services as well.
The American Legion has over 3,000 accredited representatives nationwide designed, and they're professionally trained to help veterans. And we also have representatives at the service, or at the regional offices, and at the Board of Veterans Appeals.
PVA is similar to the other groups. We have about 70 service officers which handle claims. Their trained service officers go through extensive training, similar to DAV and the other VSOs. They help all veterans, not just those with catastrophic injuries.
I applaud all of your organizations because, as you all know, you are very often the first line of defense for helping your colleagues get the benefits that they deserve. So I thank you all for that, and I yield back my time, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Members, any other questions? With that, we probably will each have questions for the record that we'll follow up. We thank you for your testimony today. I would ask that all members would have 5 legislative days with which to revise and extend their remarks without objection. So ordered. And with that, this hearing is adjourned.